The story that we are going to listen today is a very different kind of true story. The story is about a man named Robert Scott who dreamed only one thing in his life, and that was the discovery of the South Pole. Could he fulfill his dreams? Could he reach there? Let's listen that in today's story. The name of the story is The Journey to the South Pole, written by Manasi Koke, read by Rahul Koke and Manasi Koke, video editing by Ameya Kulkarni. This is the creation of Manthan Learning Resources. Antarctica, a very large continent at the south pole of the Earth, with an area of around 8 lakh square kilometers, the region has only one and one king. Snow, snow, and snow. It's a 600 feet deep ice kingdom. The average annual temperature is around minus 55 degrees Celsius. Just like sandstorms come in the desert, we have to deal with snowstorms here. The geography here is amazing. The sun does not set here during the summer months, that is from October to May. The rays reflected from the ice are so intense that a person can be blind. The sun shines so brightly that even the hundreds of kilometers of snow-capped mountains are easily visible to the naked eyes. So what you see at a very short distance is actually several kilometers away. Adding to that is the mirage-like colorful hallucinations. Sometimes there are colorful shapes in the sky. Sometimes the sun or the moon is seen hovering around. In winter, which lasts for many months, even when there is no sun, the horizon is full of feathers. When the sun goes down after May, this kingdom of ice, which sinks into the darkness, wakes up again in October. When there are no blizzards, there is only scary, cremative silence. Why would anyone want to go to such a continent of Antarctica and reach the South Pole without even stopping at the shore? But you never know what will motivate a person and he or she would make it his or her goal. This is the story of the journey of some such adventurous, curious, courageous, and brave-minded minds and the discovery of South Pole. There are many adventurous, wonderful stories of discoveries of many unknown lands in the world during 15th to 17th centuries. In fact, these discoveries were started by the countries of the European continent with a view to understand the world, but later they also tried to rule these places. But the two sellers, Norway's Roald Amundsen and England's Robert Scott, they were the first to reach the South Pole for the first time and hoist their country's flag without even knowing the possibility of such a so-called big advantages of ruling the place. Roald Amundsen, a resident of Norway, overwhelmed by experiences of many successful and unsuccessful sea expeditions near the North Pole. Amundsen, who failed to reach the North Pole for the first time, was now pursuing only a single goal of his life, which was to hoist the Norwegian flag for the first time at the South Pole. This marked the beginning of Amundsen's expedition to the South Pole on June 3, 1910. At that time, Amundsen had relied on only 120 snow dogs. Robert Scott, originally an English naval officer, but from the beginning he was fascinated by sea adventures. Like Amundsen, he also wanted to be the first to hoist the Union Jack, that is the flag of England, at the South Pole. In 1905, Scott launched the Discovery expeditions to Antarctica. Scott then became so popular in England that he almost became England's national hero. So when he appealed to the youth for his expedition to reach the South Pole, around 8,000 youths registered. It is easy to imagine how intense the craze for adventure was in those days. In June 10, Robert Scott Terra Nova with 60 sailors, some scientists, 3 engine carriages, horses brought from Siberia, and 34 dogs set sail on the banks of the River Thames. Unaware of Amundsen's campaign, Scott embarked on a journey towards his goal. A telegram fell into the hands of Robert Scott at Melbourne. "I am heading south too," Roald Amundsen. This telegram changed the nature of the goal. Now the journey has become a thrilling and life-threatening race to reach the South Pole for the first time. Crisis overshadowed Scott's expedition on the very first day itself. The storm and the wind blew so hard that one of the dogs was thrown out of the ship and then again fell back on the ship. When he arrived in Antarctica, the ship's water pump failed and he also had to deal with icebergs. In January 1911, the Terra Nova arrived at the McMurdo site of the coast of Antarctica. About 3 kilometers from here, Scott's team worked tirelessly for 6 days and set up their first base called Hut Point. This base was made using wooden planks. Scott's team had been working for 6 consecutive days from dawn to midnight, unloading the luggage from his ship on the shore, carrying it 3 kilometers on an engine-driven or a dog cart, and setting up wooden cabins over there. Now Scott's team was heading 800 miles to the South Pole. In such campaigns, not everyone has to cover the distance with their belongings. As a way to get back on the way, we had to set up camps at various places and keep the equipment there. There was no need to carry forward the research team. Scott's plan was to slowly send each group back to the base and to keep the last group of 4 for the last base. The last base was erected with the name One Ton Depot. From now on, the base would not be built. The team now had to carry their own luggage with themselves. Scott was expected to announce a 4-man squad for the South Pole, but Robert Scott announced 5 names: Robert Scott, Dr. Wilson, Evans, Captain Oates, and Lieutenant Bowers. Dr. Wilson. Edward Wilson was a doctor who was involved in Scott's first campaign, but he was also a great painter. Pictures of the surrounding area, the penguins, and his colleagues are still available today. Lieutenant Bowers, the youngest in the group. Only 28 years old boy. He was physically quite strong. One night, when the tent was blown away in a storm, all had to spend the night in the snow. That cold hurt others, but the Bowers was quite cool. Captain Oates. He was in the army. Very calm and less talkative. You tell him to do any work, he would do it without any complaint. Captain Oates was in charge of the horses in the team. Evans. Evans was a simple sailor, but a very special friend of Scott. He was an expert in many important works. Most importantly, he was specialized in repairing tents and carts. The final stage of the South Pole began with 2 push carts and team of five. They were 120 kilometers away from the pole. Amundsen's group did not want to give importance to this scientific research. His only target was the South Pole. He had saved other dogs by killing weak dogs during the journey. Amundsen's group also had sharp, experienced and adventurous men. Since Norway was very close to the North Pole, he was well acquainted to live in ice, and most importantly, Amundsen's base was 60 miles ahead from the South Pole compared to the Scots. And even on the journey, Amundsen was 100 kilometers ahead of Scott's team. The journey of the last team was a calendar of different difficulties. One day the storm blew away the tent, and Dr. Wilson and Bowers had to bear the cold for the whole night. Ivan's hands got hurt while repairing carts. He was trying to cover that up. Bowers was traveling in plain shoes without ski shoes. And Robert Scott? He was leading the team and moving ahead, hiding all his stress and fears. 16th January 1912. They saw the signs on the ice and realized that the Union Jack, to whom they wanted to get the honor of getting hoisted first at the South Pole, was not going to get it. They would see another flag flying there. January 18, 1912. Scott's team reaches the South Pole. The Norwegian flag was flying on a tent set up there. Amundsen had arrived on December 14, 1911, just 35 days before Scott. None of the ambition that got Scott to this point fell into his hands. He would be known as a leader of a failed campaign without the respect he had deserved for his country. With a heavy heart, he waved his flag. They clicked some photos. Dr. Wilson drew some pictures. Scott's diary recorded the day.
The Union Jack, which was given to us by our Queen Alexandra, was humiliated.
Scott and his team had no time to grieve. They had to move back as soon as possible. The last line in Scott's diary on the South Pole is,
"The worst has happened. We have to look back at our shattered ambitions. Our dreams have been shattered and we want to walk 120 kilometers once again."
On the way back, adversity hit Scott's team. Wilson lost his sight due to sunlight reflected from the ice. The veins of his leg also swelled. Scott himself fell into the ice twice. Ivan suffered multiple wounds to his face from the blizzard. His two fingernails also fell off. He had nothing to do. It was not possible for him to set up even a tent and reassemble it. He was getting angry with himself. It is truly astonishing that he continued his research in such situation. During this time, he did many things, including collecting stone specimens from different parts of Antarctica and collecting frozen bones of animals which were buried millions of years ago. On February 10, 11, the snow started a little earlier that year. The footprints of their vehicles, which were supposed to be used as markings, began to fade. Scott writes in his February 11 diary,
"Today we spent almost 3 hours looking for a way out. We thought we have gone to the right too much. So we moved to the left and then we felt we are on the far left. Everything was getting messy. What if you can't find a way? That was a very scary thought."
Now disagreements and fights had begun in the group. Scott had to start rationing of food. February 17. A bad day for Scott's team. Injuries, inadequate food, weakness, and poor mental health all began to have devastating effects on Evans. He tried to walk, but he was failing behind everyone. Taking one step at a time became a daunting task. Scott writes in his diary,
"I turned around and went to him, and I was shocked. He could not even get up from the place where he had fallen. He was crawling. His face and hands were bleeding, and he had a look of despair in his eyes. We both grabbed him by the arm and drove him a little. But he fainted again and fell to the ground. Finally, Oates stayed with him. I went ahead and brought the cart. We put him in a cart and brought him to the tent. By then, he was almost in coma."
Evans died around midnight that night. It was a shocking event for all four of them. The 110 depot was still 115 kilometers long. After this, the intensity of the cold increased. Scott had planned this journey after a thorough study of the climate of Antarctica. According to that, winter was still a month and a half away. But this time, now itself, the temperature started falling to minus 40, 45 degrees. Even simple movements were difficult in such cold weather. It took half an hour to put on simply shoes. According to the calculated dates, Scott's team was supposed to arrive at 110 depot in the first week of March, but Scott and his team were still battling with Antarctica's climate at a distance of 100 kilometers. Captain Oates. The wounds of his leg were becoming worse day by day when he realized that his team's pace was slowing down and the foot problem was getting worse. He asked Scott for the poison, which was reserved for such occasions only. He knew that if his other three friends should arrive safely as soon as possible, he had no choice but to commit suicide. Scott refused. "If it is hard to give poison straightly, then don't wake me up in the morning. Leave the tent and just go away," Oates suggested. But Scott was not ready for that either. One day, he woke up in the morning and wrote a letter to Scott. "Don't try to find me." Oates left to save his colleague's life, never to return. He went to the blizzard. Scott wrote about Oates in his diary.
"He was a brave soldier. He was enduring the dying pain with a smile. He remained optimistic until the last moment. When it became impossible, he followed the path of death. The time has come for us all to set an example."
March 18. They were now only 33 kilometers from 110 depot. They had enough food for 2 days. There was enough oil for 1 day. And a blizzard was raging outside. It was not possible to go further. All three of them had an idea of their fate till March 22nd, 3rd. Scott wrote in his diary on that day,
"The storm is still strong. Wilson and Bowers can't even get out of bed. We have run out of fuel. Our end is near. But no matter what happens, we have decided not to eat poison and to face death peacefully."
As captain of the team, Scott decided to carry out 3 responsibilities. He wrote 3 letters. One to Wilson's wife. He wrote in it,
"Wilson was always enthusiastic and helpful to others. I actually brought him into a failed campaign and ruined his life. But he never blamed me. I had no words for condolence. All I can say is that he lived like a hero and died like a hero.
He wrote to Bauer's mother,
"Your son was with me until the last moment of the campaign. My life ended in the company of two knights, and I am proud to say, mother, one of these two knights was your son."
In a letter to his wife, he wrote,
"Make our child a student of nature. Some schools have such facilities. Put his name in such a school. Don't let him be lazy. Make him a hard worker."
March 26, 1912. The last entry in Scott's diary.
"We are only 11 miles from the depot. The storm is raging now. Our end is near. I can't write a single letter anymore. God, keep my people happy. Robert Scott."
Scott was writing the diary almost till the end, not knowing whether his diary would be read in the future or not. But still, Scott kept a record of all geographical and scientific research he felt which was important. But he also kept writing about his mental state. 8 months later, the search team found out the bodies of the three men. Today, the tombs of these three daring land explorers are there at the South Pole near the 110 depot. Robert Scott and his team, the so-called failed man. Maybe according to some people, Scott was a crazy man who endangered everyone's life, and that too with no reason. Later, he was criticized in many ways. In fact, it is a very important and a must-study subject that whether Scott's leadership was worthy or not. But what about Evans, who continued his research till the last moment of his life? Or Oates, who went out in a blizzard for his teammates? Or Scott, who manages his team's morale despite knowing that they are unlikely to reach safely in such a situation? We should try to understand what they are trying to say. We should be able to get at least one moment in our life when we can say, "I'm not just breathing, I'm living." Living in real sense. Can we think about how to live and why to live our lives? Rather, can we find out one reason which can tell us to die for what? Can we re-examine our own definitions of right and wrong, success and failure? And can we find one life goal for which we want to live, or maybe we want to die for? What could be a greater tribute to Scott and his colleagues than this?